Now this, my friends, is the mouse I've been waiting for. The brand new Razer Deathadder version 2. For those that follow me on social or Twitch, you'll know that I've been testing a mouse since November last year, which, spoiler alert, was this one all along. Now I've been a Deathadder boy ever since it replaced my IntelliMouse 3.0 in the form of the original 3G model, and whilst I have admittedly had brief moments away with an MM530 or most recently EC2, I always seem to find myself going back to whatever the latest model happens to be. Now this isn't necessarily because the Deathadder has outperformed them as such, and I'd happily continue using the EC2 if I had to. It's just that it's always been the most comfortable mouse for me that I've competed at in tournaments, and is simultaneously enabled me to perform at my best, and ultimately that's the most important attribute. So as for the Deathadder version 2, well, it's a right-handed ergonomically designed gaming mouse with up to 8 programmable buttons, and that's through Synapse 3.0. With my 19x10cm hand size, it will sit alongside the IntelliMouse Pro and slot right in between the Zowie EC1 and 2 in size, with a length of 127mm, height of 43, and width at the grip position of roughly 62. To reiterate on the reason I lean toward mice like this would be to mention their gradual slopes toward their highest point on the back and thus central hump, which additionally means that vertical adjustments are far easier with my palm and claw type hybrid grip. The most impressive element here though is that despite those dimensions and the feature set we're about to list, it weighs in at just 82 grams with some cable, and does this without holes, creaking, rattling, or accidental side button actuations due to weaker internals. Now, despite those primary buttons being separated from its top shell, they do remain consistent right the way through, with both mouse 1 and 2 feeling identical. Underneath, Razer have implemented their optical switch rated for 70 million clicks that can also be found on the Viper. These utilize infrared beams for actuation, meaning that no physical contact is required in order to send a signal to your computer, essentially increasing your response time whilst eliminating the need for a debounce delay and thus potential double clicks over time due to degradation. On the side, and similar to the IntelliMouse Pro that the Deathadder was inspired by, its side buttons remain pretty much best in class and additionally allow you to roll your thumb to activate them. That, and they've even gotten rid of those awful side grips previously found on the Elite, and that's in favour of the injection moulded ridges, which, by the way, have yet to wear down during 3 months of hardcore usage on the pre-production sample they sent for testing. There's also a 24-step scroll wheel attached, and absolutely every button on this mouse is, in my opinion, flawless. Here's a listen. On the front, Razer have attached a 2.1m Speedflex cable that I absolutely adore. It slots easily into my Zowie Kamar 2 Bungee 2, so there's no problems there. Plus, I'd say that it offers the right amount of flex, and compared to other cables, is less likely to end up under your mouse when swiping. It's basically an invisible cable that you can see, if that makes any sense. Sure, a wireless version of the Deathadder would be great in future, but hey, one mouse at a time, please. Underneath, you find the improved 100% PTFE mouse feet and profile toggle. That, and Razer's latest Focus Plus optical sensor. This features DPI in increments of 50, from 100 right the way through to 20,000, and I'm not able to detect any hint of discernible smoothing across the board either. In that respect, you'll likely start to experience jitter once you start pushing crazy high DPI values, but Razer have ultimately gone all out here by implementing what I can only describe as the most snappy sensor on the market today as a result, no matter your chosen step. Taking a quick look at Synapse 3.0, under Customize, you'll be able to program up to 8 buttons, and that's to pretty much anything you could possibly think of as well, which additionally include the optional use of Razer's Hypershift function that offers a second layer when active. Under Performance, you'll be able to set a single DPI step, which might otherwise free up the 2 dedicated buttons on top, or up to 5 steps that include the default values of 400, 800, 1600, 2400, and 3200. On that note, this might be the first time we've seen Razer remove the out-of-the-box 1800 DPI step. Not that it matters, it's just kind of interesting to mention. You can also choose to separate X from Y in terms of DPI as well, which may actually be useful if you play games like CS or Battalion, where you're more concerned about horizontal than you are vertical, i.e. tracking level for headshots. It's also for this reason some people even liked angle snapping back in the day, though this option is sadly not present at this time. As for calibration, the out-of-the-box liftoff distance is set to 2 mm, and that's through its automatic setting that can be further adjusted to 1 or 3 depending on your preference. There's also an asymmetrical cutoff feature that essentially means the distance the mouse will begin to track when lowering it to your surface, and it may help reduce drift, so consider experimenting. LOD is always below 2 DVDs no matter the setting though, and below 1 when set to 1 mm, or at least on the black cloth pads that I've tried. So because the Razer Focus Plus sensor is new to both myself and this channel, I've decided to go ahead and include a bunch of in-game real-world tests. So for acceleration, moving the DeathAdder version 2 from left to right of my Gigantus pad until it stopped tracking both slow and fast shows we end up in roughly the same place, and that's of course taken into account some small amount of human error. Now acceleration can be good, but only when it can be controlled and thus added by the user in-game afterwards, and here, absolutely no complaints, great implementation. As for its max tracking speed, I can pretty much swipe the mouse as fast as humanly possible, and that's thanks to the most ridiculous max tracking speed I've ever seen on a sensor of roughly 16.5 meters per second without malfunction. Holy crap. In terms of button latency, I could include a bump test, but to be honest, it's really not needed. This clip and tweet from the day I received my sample will otherwise tell you everything you need to know because, well, this thing is goddamn fast. Whilst your results may of course differ because after all we're all human, I don't think you'll have any issues with latency on this thing, that's for sure. Finally, whilst we know there's no debouncing present in the optical switches, the proof is really in the pudding here as there are no issues with executing mini jumps in Shoot Mania. An otherwise too high of a debounce time would make our smallest jump a medium-sized jump, and this is because the button wouldn't have been released quick enough before the second was activated. This also means there are no issues with full height rocket jumps in Quake because both mouse 1 and 2 can be pushed down simultaneously without delay, i.e. you won't find yourself jumping before you shoot or shooting before you jump. You'll always reach maximum height. So final thoughts, well, where do I start? It's really hard to review a DeathAdder without being incredibly biased, but I also want to point out here that in my previous reviews of the 2013 Chroma and Elite models, I was also brutally honest about the things I didn't like. I mean, after all, I want this mouse to be good and it's important to be critical. And in reference to that, I still refer to the 2013 era as the dark age of gaming mice, where smoothing became a thing. It wasn't just that mouse of course, but it would go on to plague the industry, and it's where I actually started reviewing mice in the first place, as I simply needed a replacement. I later returned with the release of the Chroma that addressed it, and then most recently the Elite, but that Elite, I mean, that mouse whilst being a perfect weapon in game just wasn't feature complete. There was no 400 DPI step out of the box, or even onboard memory to work around it, and those rubber grips on the side, well, they just fell off in humid environments. This new version 2 though, my god, it might just be flawless. It really is like they've watched every one of my video reviews over the last however many years and then just fixed and addressed everything. So much so that I spent the last 10 days, no, the last 3 months trying to introduce a negative for this review, and you know what? I really can't. The only possible thing you might even consider complaining about here is Synapse 3.0, but even that has developed to the point now where I'm happy to have it installed. So in short, I absolutely love playing with this mouse, period. It's the same shape I've known and loved, but simply lighter, and yet not so light that it's made sacrifices to build quality in order to hit a number. Tracking is a pleasure, holding angles is a pleasure, looking at it is a pleasure. It's ultimately the best DeathAdder they've ever made, with nothing that will let you down, and with everything designed to help you play at your best. So I'll promise you this, if you're a fan of the shape, then this mouse will be your endgame, or until they make a wireless one. And then it'll be pretty much down to your wallet. But NVC, I hear you say, there must be a catch. Well sure, despite straightening up that right side ever so slightly to address some minor complaints, to which I'm also a fan by the way, the shape hasn't really changed in years, and you'll probably already know if you'll love or hate it in advance. If you're really not interested in the shell, then fear not my friends, thanks to that last generation PMW3360 sensor, pretty much every mouse today is a competitive one. So just find a shape you love and, well, you do you. Anyway, I'd like to take a quick moment and thank Razer for saving me a bunch of money because I'd otherwise have to buy it, and hopefully this is the kickstart we need to take their EC series to the next level this year. After all, I do love competition, and Razer has certainly entered 2020 with a bang. In the meantime though, if you've liked the video, make sure to give it a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already, and do stop by my Twitch stream where I broadcast weekly. For now though, if you have any questions or comments, leave them down below and I'll get back to you, but otherwise take care, keep gaming, and I'll catch you in the next video.